really glad you guys are here this morning, and thank you for braving the cold, wet weather and being in God's house. That tells me that God's presence is your priority, and it's important to you to be in God's house with God's people. So we want to welcome you guys. Welcome to Mountain Movers Church. If you are a newcomer today, we say welcome to our family. If you're viewing online, we want to tell you welcome this morning. Hope you're nice and cozy, enjoying this day. We're really glad that you're with us today. And so we are going to be finalizing part three to this series, The Tipping Point. How many of you guys have enjoyed this teaching? Yes? Has it been helpful? Good. We've really enjoyed teaching it. It's been really, really good for us to be able to get God's truth of His Word out to His people, because we are already, I'm telling you guys, we are already seeing lives really impacted and changed by this series. It's amazing how supernatural God just interacts and intervenes in our lives when we step out in faith and step out in obedience. God begins to move mountains on our behalf. And so we're really, really excited about what He's doing. So just as a quick recap, okay, you guys ready for this? Wow. Dude, we're going to pray right now.
Hey, I bet some of you guys were ready for the Bedlam game last night, and you were probably a little more excited than you are this morning
Listen
in God's house,
Listen
right?
To this.
So are you ready for God's word this morning?
Yes.
All right.
If you would, let's bow and let's go to God this morning. Father, we are grateful to be in your house, hearing your word. Your word is powerful. It's life-changing. It touches us and changes us right where we are at. We're so grateful, God, for what you're wanting to do in this place, in our hearts, in our lives, with our children, in our communities, Father God, at work. We are thankful, and we thank you in advance for everything you have done, everything you're doing right now, and everything you will do, because you are God and there is none like you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen. So how many of you guys, as a recap, want financial freedom in your life? Amen. What is financial freedom? It is two things. Are you ready? It is God's provision and God's protection. It has very little to do with finances. Now, it has something to do with finances, obviously, but it has very, very little to do with finances and has everything to do with favor. I want to say that again. Financial freedom has very little to do with finances and has everything to do with God's favor in your life. It's about God's provision and God's protection. Financial freedom is really about God's favor. I want you to understand that, because in a nutshell, that is what this entire series is really, really about. In fact, I'll say it this way. I would rather have God's favor in my life than to have all the money in the world. I would rather have God's favor in my life than all of the money in the world. Why on earth? Now, if I had a choice, I would rather have all the money in the world and God's favor. If He chooses to do that, I welcome that in my life, Lord. I welcome it. But I would rather, if I had to choose, I would rather choose God's favor, because God brings the increase and He supplies all of our needs according to His riches and glory. I'm going to let you in on a little secret. We serve a God, the Bible says He owns the cattle amongst a thousand hills. That's a lot of cattle. How many of you guys know anything about cattle at all? Have you ever pulled over beside the road and at least mooed at one, right? Okay, you know something about cattle, all right? The market today, what does cattle go for right now? A really good fat beef cow at the market, what's it sell for these days? $1,800. Who wants $1,800? Okay, one good cow at the market goes for about $1,800. The Bible says He owns all the cattle on all the hills. That's what that Hebrew phrasing really means. It means He owns it all. But you know, one hill full of cattle, that's pretty awesome. But a thousand in the Hebrew really means infinity. He owns it all. You can't even really count 1,000 hills. It's just a lot of hills, and it's a lot of cattle, and he owns it all. Here's my point. When you are a child of God, you have the access to tap into the God that owns it all. So I don't need to own it all. I'm a bondservant of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm his servant, and I belong to him. And so that means I don't need to worry about paying my bills at the end of the month as long as I am serving in obedience, because God is going to pay my bills for me. He's my master. I'm his servant. He's going to take care of his people if, circle that, if we are obedient in serving him. If we are in right positioning with God, he will provide and protect us all the days of our lives. We told you earlier in this series, there was a time when Misty and I were so dirt poor, we couldn't even afford dirt. It was bad. And it was so bad, it was true. We couldn't even afford dirt.
We needed dirt for our yard, I remember.
We needed dirt.
We were like, we
brought in, and we could not afford
to
buy dirt. It's expensive. Cheap as dirt. All right. Ooh. Boo, Pastor Brad. Boo. What? You don't know what I'm doing. Cheap as dirt. It's a phrase. It was supposed to be funny. Obviously, it wasn't funny, so I'm booing myself. So God provided and protected us through that entire time in our lives. Even though we were dirt poor, we were absolutely happy. We were content. We were blessed. We were fulfilled. God always met our needs. I want to tell you a quick story. This is funny, okay? So, did I say we were dirt broke? Really, really bad poor, okay? And so this check comes in the mail. This is just one of many instances where God just intervened in our lives. We were always obedient to pay the tithe, always. We wouldn't go without it. So this check comes in the mail from a very large retail store for $420 in our name. And I called their customer service department and I said, hey, I think there's a mistake. I don't know why you guys sent me $420. I mean, we need it. Bad, but I'm telling you that I think this is a mistake. Will you please check the records? And they said, no, Mr. Helton, we see this as a credit to you. We don't really know where this credit has come from. We don't know why this credit has happened, but in fact, we owed you $420. I'm thinking, they don't owe us $420. We've not even hardly done business with this store at all. We've shopped there, but we buy everything in cash, so they don't owe us any money. We know they don't owe us money. And so I said, all right, this is legitimate, right? They're like, yes, sir. So I'm going to deposit this check for $420 to Brad Helton. I'm depositing it, and you're okay with it, right? Do you guys record these calls for quality assurance purposes? Yes, sir, Mr. Helton, we do. That's your money. Go ahead and deposit it. We deposited the money. We get a call from them 30 days later saying, there must have been some sort of mistake. We don't know why that check was distributed to you, but we didn't owe you that money. And I said, but you told me to deposit that money, and I did, and it's gone. I spent it. So long story short, God's favor was still with us. We have legal insurance, and our attorneys wrote some letters and said, they don't owe you anything because you told them it was theirs and they get to keep it. So went on and on for about 6 months. We didn't have to pay a dime of it. It was ours, free $420 when we were dirt broke poor. Why? God's provision and God's protection. We needed that money really, really bad. And God turned the hand of some company in our favor. He tipped the scale in our favor because of our obedience to God. That's just one little story. That happened over and over and over constantly. It happened. Why? Because we were obedient to what God had called us to do. So do we need money? Absolutely. We absolutely need money. All right? Try going to the grocery store and buying your groceries without money. It'll be a little awkward. All right? It will be a little awkward. But you can show up with all your groceries at the cashier and you can say, but Jesus loves you. And I love you very much. Well, that's great. But you're going to either need to pay for the groceries or you need to put the groceries back. We do need money, right? How many of you guys need money to survive, correct? All right, if we were living in the middle of Africa somewhere in, tribal hut kind of situation where we just lived off of the resources of the land, it might be a little bit different. But here, we actually kind of need money. Okay, so God can use money, though, to bless us and to provide for us and to protect us, okay? So the scale is God's scale, right? And the weights on the scale are our choices, all right? Now, a lot of times what we do in life is we work, trying to make more money so that we can supposedly tip the scale in our favor, making more money. More money does not give us financial freedom. If you want to tip the scale in your favor, you need God's provision and God's protection, because you have no promises of what will happen to that money. That money can be gone like that. What you need, that's why I say I'd rather have God's provision and God's protection than all the money in the world, because you take the money away and I still have God's provision and God's protection. I don't need to worry about anything. Matthew 6 says, do not worry. Don't worry about what you're going to eat or what you're going to drink. The birds don't worry about what they're doing. They're just birds. They do what they're supposed to do. Do birds still get up in the morning early? Do they still go to work looking for the worm? Yes. Do they still gather for their nest? Yes. I am not saying stay home and live by faith and expect God to pay your bills. Get off your rear end and work. The Bible says if you do not work, you do not eat. Do not think that you can sit idle and make any provision for your family or your home. You are expected to work. Go back to Adam. God said, you will work. By the sweat of your brow, you will work. So do your part. Do your job, work, and God will bless you as you remain in right positioning and in obedience with Him. So you want to tip the scale in your favor. It's all about bringing the first of your increase, your finances, to God. The first 10% goes to God. I'm not a good mathematician, but I'm going to give this a shot. Ready? If I make $1,000 in a month, how much do I give to God? 100. Thank you. Okay. All right. When I get my paycheck, what is the first thing I should do? Pay my tithe right off the top. But Pastor Brad, you don't understand. Something might happen. Something might come up. Good thing I've got God, because that's where He comes in, right? Good thing I'm responsible and I'm a manager of the resources He's given me, right? Good thing I live by a budget, right? Are there unsuspected, things that just arise, circumstances that just happen? Absolutely. That's what God's for, right? That's where He comes in, His provision and His protection. So if I make $1 million, all right? Let's say my Aunt Bertha wins the lotto and she writes me a check for $1 million, right? What is the first thing I'm going to do? No, I'm going to dance. I'm going to freak out and I'm going to scream. I'm going to say, thank you, Jesus. I'm going to run around my house. And then I'm going to write a check for how much? $100,000. Any increase at all that comes my way. If somebody gives me a gift card for $100, notice I didn't say 25, because I don't really like that know what 10% of 25 is. So of $100, if somebody gives me $100, what am I going to do? A gift card. What am I going to do? The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to give an offering of $10 to the house of God. Do we get it? Simple. All right, so we want to share something really exciting that has happened. I know that God has done a lot in a lot of people's lives in this church through the tithe, okay? I know that. I want to share just one little story of something that actually happened this week. It's really exciting. So if you guys will give your attention, I would like to invite JD and Josie Hart up on the platform to join us at this time. If you guys will come this way, you can give them a hand as they come. Come on up here, guys. JD and Josie are really, really new to Mountain Movers Church. You guys just stand next to Misty right there. Come on up here. Really, really new to Mountain Movers Church, and really, really new, like this week new, to tithing, All right. Awesome. Yes. Awesome. So I get this message, right, from them last Sunday afternoon. And they were like, Pastor, you're going to freak out. You're not going to believe what happened. All right. So I want them just real quick to just share what happened. Last week, we preached this part two, and then you messaged me and tell me what happened.
Okay. A little bit of backstory. Where this blessing from God came from was from our old power company when we were still in Mississippi. And we had had problems with them before. They would get our account crossed and they would shut the power off and we'd have to go and argue and fight to get it turned back on. We left Biloxi in July of 2013. So we've been away for a little bit now. And I'm at work and she tells me, she's like, this is going to make your day. We just got a check from the power company for $670. And I didn't believe it. I was at work, so by the time I got home, she was already asleep, and I looked. And as sure as we're both standing here, there was a check from Xcel Energy in Biloxi, Mississippi for $670. Now, what brought this about was, much like the video last week, we sat down and said, you know, we really do need to do our tithe at the beginning of the month when we get the check and not just what we have left over. And that was it. It hadn't even gotten to the point to where we were actually giving.
You just made the decision. You just made it up in your mind. This is what I'm going to do.
Yeah, we just made the decision that, hey, this is going to be the new plan. And 2 days later, this check shows up. And she was kind of giving me a little slack about it because I was telling her, I was like, well, Abel gave the best. He gave the firstborn and the fruit
right
thereof.
Preach it.
And
I'm going to go sit down.
I was like,
that's good preaching. I'm going to sit down.
I was like, I'm going to go to the bank, and from now on, when we do our tithes, it's going to be in brand new crisp money because Jesus deserves the best.
That's good. I like that.
And she was like, well, I don't know. And I was like, well, I'm doing it anyway.
That's
like
great.
That idea.
That's
but,
great.
Yeah, that is the genuine truth. We just made the choice that we were going to put him first in our finances.
That's great.
We hadn't even given yet. We just both decided. And then this check shows up out of nowhere after being out of Mississippi for a year and a half.
That's awesome.
So it was a big deal. It was a blessing. And it's all because of what we've been going over here, tipping the scales in our favor.
That's
and
awesome.
You do that by showing your favor to the Lord.
Yes.
You give him your favor, and he's going to take care of everything you need.
That's good. So out of curiosity, when did you guys give your lives to Christ?
It was, Father's Day of June of this year.
Awesome. Praise God. Praise God. All right, give them a hand. Thank you guys so much. And notice her shirt. Blessed.
That's
I love
awesome.
It. I love it. Thank you guys very much for sharing. That's what I'm talking about, guys. And they're just brand new at this, right? They just made a decision, hadn't even actually done it yet, but just said, God, we're just going to dedicate, and it starts in your mind. God, we're just going to dedicate this to you, and look at what God did, $600 and some odd.
That's right. You know what's amazing? As pastors, it's not easy to get up in front of people and talk on a topic that is so controversial because so many people go, I don't want to go to church because they just want your money. And it's not about wanting your money. It's about the favor of God on your lives. And so as we started teaching this series a few weeks ago, we started praying, God, show the people, show them. Once they make it up in their mind, God, prove yourself real to them. That was my prayer every day. And when they literally took a video of that check and sent it to us. And I was like, that is exactly what we were praying. Like, they hadn't even given it yet, but they'd made up their mind. This is what we're going to do. And it always starts with a decision. You want to drop 10 pounds? It starts right here. You want to get your life right? It starts right here. You want God to tip the scale in your favor? It starts right here before it touches your pocketbook, right? Well, I want to ask you a question. You may say, okay, so I understand the blessings and favor of God come on my life when I tithe, but what else does it do? Well, let me answer that for you, okay? Jesus Christ came to this earth for one purpose. He came to this earth to give his life so that people like you and me could come back into a real relationship with Almighty God. See, in the very beginning, God had a plan, and that was he wanted to have a relationship with people. He wanted to talk to you and I just like we talk face to face as a couple. God wanted that, and Adam and Eve, humanity, we messed it up. But Jesus came and he gave his life on the cross, and then 3 days later, he rose again so that we could have our sins forgiven and have that relationship, right? Well, when he ascended, before he ascended, he left what is called the Great Commission. And he told his disciples, he said, listen, here's the plan. I've done my part, okay? I've done my part, and now I'm going back to where I belong. I'm going back to the right hand of the Father. I'm going back into heaven. I'm going to ascend. But here's what I want you to do. I want you to go. I don't want you to spread this message. And he said, here's the plan. I've got plan A. I want you, the church, to go spread the message of why I came and gave my life. I want you, the church, to go tell my story. It's his story. The word of God is his story. Excuse me. So he said, I want you to go and I want you to do this. So he left. And what did the disciples do? The disciples went and they started planting churches. They went into every town and they started telling people about Jesus and they started forming churches. See, God had a plan A for the message of his son to get out there, and it was the local church. He had one plan. He doesn't have a plan B. His plan was that we, his people, would bring in our first. And if we all do our part and we bring in the first, then the message of Jesus Christ reaches more and more and more and more and more and more people every day. I want to take you all the way back to a story way back in the Old Testament in 2 Chronicles. It's about, I don't know, a third of the way into the Bible. 2 Chronicles chapter 31. I'm going to kind of give you some context, okay? This is a story about a king, Ahaz, who had been ruling at that time. And in that day and time, the temple was what we would consider the church today, okay? So the temple, hey, can you take that down for 1 second? They're all reading it while I'm talking. There we go.
Bunch
right
of
here.
Cheaters. Quit reading that scripture.
Like, you're going to find out before I tell you. I want to tell the story. Let me set you up to where we're going with that. So Ahaz is king, and he has no regard for God. None whatsoever. Israel had this. The whole Old Testament is a story of the people of Israel, okay? The children of Israel, which are Jewish people, God's chosen. And Ahaz had no regard for God. He basically was like, look, I'm going to do what I want, when I want, and how I want to do it. If you were here last week, that kind of sounds like Cain. Ahaz was the same way. And he said, so forget the temple. You know what? We don't need the temple. We don't need the sacrifices. We don't need the offering or the priests or the Levites or anything else. Shut the doors. All right, now I want you to think about this. If you close off a house and nobody goes in it for a month or 2 months or a year, what happens? It totally starts going downhill. It runs down, right? The grass starts growing up. The inside, the paint starts looking kind of nasty. It gets really dusty and gross. That's what happened to the temple because Ahaz closed it off. All right, well, God took care of Ahaz, and he was like, done with you. You won't honor me, so I'm going to put in King Hezekiah. King Hezekiah came onto the scene as the king, and all the people had not been serving God, all right? So imagine you're now the king, and nobody is serving God. But you are the king, so what you say goes. And King Hezekiah said, look, we're going to get back to where our ancestors were. When the temple was built, King David and King Solomon had a plan in mind, and that is we're going to follow the law. We're going to do what God told us to do. So King Hezekiah says, we're going to go in, and we are going to clean up the temple. So they went in, and they had a cleaning party, and they cleaned it up, and they got everything just the way it was supposed to be. And then he said, I'm going to personally bring my first. And I'm going to show you as an example, I'm going to bring my first as the king, and I want you all to follow suit. Now, we're going to pick up in verse 4, and I'm going to show you what happens in this passage. And he says this, in addition to him bringing his first, he required the people in Jerusalem to bring a portion of their goods to the priest and the Levites so they could devote themselves fully to the law of God. When the people of Israel heard these requirements, they responded generously. Everybody say generously. By bringing the what? The first share of their grain, their new wine, their olive oil, their honey, and all the produce of their fields. They brought a large quantity, a tithe of all they produced. The people who had moved to Judah from Israel and the people of Judah themselves brought in the tithe of their cattle, their sheep, their goats, and the tithe of the things that had been dedicated to the Lord their God, and they piled them in great heaps. They began piling them up in late spring. Listen to this. And the heaps continued to grow until early autumn. How amazing is that? When Hezekiah and his officials came, they saw the huge piles and they thanked the Lord and his people, Israel, Where did all this come from? Hezekiah asked the priests and the Levites. And Ahaz, the high priest from the family of Zadok, replied, "Since the people began bringing their gifts to the Lord's temple, we have had enough to eat and plenty to spare. The Lord has blessed his people, and all this is leftovers." I want you to know that from day one, way back in the Old Testament, before Jesus even came on the scene and the church of today was established, God had a plan A, and that was bring all of your first into the storehouse so that my work can be done. You see, God, when he told us to come here and plant Mountain Movers Church, God didn't need one more church in Northeast Oklahoma. He didn't need another church like all the other churches, but what he needed was a different kind of church. God told us to come here and plant a church that would not be like every other church. He told us to plant a church that unchurched people would want to attend. That's why we do things a little bit different. That's why when you come in, the lights are down in worship, because who wants to be embarrassed? If you want to raise your hand, it's between you and Jesus. It's not for anybody else to see you doing that. That's why we do so many different things. That's why there's no dress code. Wear some clothes. We're good with that. You come in without any, we'll bless you with a new outfit, right? We don't care what you wear. We care about sharing his story and leading people into a real and life-changing relationship with Jesus that's contagious. We care about teaching people how to live a balanced life so that all of their life is blessed, not just one portion, not just their spirit, but their bodies are healthy and their finances are in order. That's why we came here to do something different. And you may think to yourself, that's awesome. That's amazing. Do you know that just like a family, it takes finances to run a family. It takes finances to run a local church. It takes finances to reach people for Jesus. Have you ever tried to bless somebody, but you didn't have the finances to do it? Like your heart was there, but you didn't have the finances to do it. Do you know that all the time at this church, when we bring our tithe, we're saying yes to more people coming to know Jesus. Let me tell you, we text give. When you guys see me over there playing, I'm not like texting people on when they're giving offering. I'm text giving because I don't want to have to bring my checkbook and all this to the platform. I text give every single week, and I have some of it automated, which is awesome. It just does it automatically. But every Sunday when I do that, what I'm saying is, yes, I want more people to come to know Jesus. I did my part. I said yes to my first so that more people can come to know Jesus. But when we do not bring our first, what we're saying is, you know what? Somebody told me about Jesus, but I'm not going to help share it with other people because I'm just going to hold it to myself. Because you know what? I can't understand how it would tip the scale if I gave my 10% and it doesn't work out on my budget. Let me tell you, when you give your first, that is where logic ends and faith begins. See, the entire message of Jesus Christ is all about faith. Do you see Jesus here? Do you see him? No, we can't see him. It's faith. Can you see the wind? No, but you can feel it. You can see its effects. Can I see that Jesus is real by the people's lives that he has changed? Yes. Every single day, we watch how God works in our life, and it's by faith that we live, and it's by faith that we give. I want you to tell you that we did some research because we're all about numbers, okay? Not about the number of people in here, but we're about statistics. I love statistics. This is what I do all the time. And so we pulled together the numbers, and this is the first time we've done this in a very, very long time. But we, to the best of our ability, we pulled up the numbers. And I'm going to tell you that right now, of our regular attenders, what is a regular attender? Unfortunately, in today's society, people believe they're a regular attender if they go to church once or twice a month. Now, I would prefer as your pastor that you come way more frequently than that because I know what it's going to do in your life. But that's the stats, okay? So of regular attenders in this house of God, in this local church, 21% of regular attenders are what make everything happen. 21% bring, maybe not their 10th, maybe they're only tipping God, but they're giving something that we can track 21%. Now, I want to ask you this question. You look around, and we have a pretty nice little facility. God has blessed us immensely. We've reached hundreds upon hundreds of people. And, you know, it's kind of like preaching to a parade, as Pastor Ed Young says. There's like a revolving door. And over the years, we see people come in. We get to preach to them for a while, and out the door they go. On to something else. But over the 8 years we've been here, hundreds upon hundreds have come through. But there's only 21% of people giving some portion to make this ministry go, this local church. Now, do you know what that says to us? It says we're very blessed. Some people don't have that much coming in. But you know what it also says is we have to say no a lot. We have to say no a lot. There's a lot more outreach that we would like to do that we have to say no to. You drive up in these hills and there's tons and tons and tons of children who we would love to take a bus and go pick them up and bring them in on Wednesday night and flood this sanctuary, but we don't have the resources to do it, so that was a no. We have so many things that we would like to go into the local schools and be able to go in and help provide for them and help be able to resource the teachers and help reach out, but we have to say no. If you're a leader in this church, you've heard that word more times than you want to, like we're your parents. We want to do this! No, it's really not in the budget. We can't do that. But I want you to imagine with me, what if that number changed from 21? What if that number doubled to 42? What if that number tripled to 63%?
Good job.
I know.
I'm
I thought
like,
about
wait,
it beforehand.
I got it. Hold. Okay, good
I
job.
Liked math, actually. And maybe I wasn't the best, but I did enjoy it. I can kind of add a little bit. But I want you to just imagine, when we think about that, it blows our minds. Because it means that we could bring on full-time staff. It means we could have a youth pastor full-time. We could have a kids pastor full-time. Right now, this church operates on volunteers, and they're amazing. But we have to say no a lot.
And time is money. Imagine if you went to your job, worked full-time 40 to 50 hours a week. Maybe I'm crazy. Maybe you work 60 or 70 hours a week. But imagine doing it for free. And they just say, you're such a blessing to us. We just so, you know, and you say to yourself, I'd like to do more. I really would, but you know, I'm kind of tapped out on time and I can't buy groceries or feed my children. You know, it's so to be driven by volunteers is awesome, but imagine if we had the resources to pay people to work here in God's house to provide for their families. You can only volunteer so much, right? Because you have to work. You have to work and provide an income for your family. But imagine if we could actually pay people full-time on staff here at this church. Imagine spending, instead of maybe 10 hours a week volunteering, imagine if those same individuals could spend 40 or 50 hours a week doing what they do, 4 or 5 times the impact of what we can do for God's kingdom. That means we're reaching more people for Jesus.
You know, I'd like to ask a question. How many of you guys would say in this place, I've come to this church and I have grown as a result of being in this house? Would you raise your hands? If you look around the room, that's unbelievable. And what it tells us is the more people we get through those doors by reaching out outside of our doors, the more people will come to know Jesus.
I want to ask a similar question. If you gave your life to Christ here at this church, and we're divided into two services, and there's a lot of people who aren't even here now anymore, but if you gave your life to Christ here at this church, would you raise your hand, please? Thank you, Jesus. There's hands in the foyer going up back there.
We got
Amen.
Guys hiding
all right, hey,
there.
Can you guys give a hand?
Yes.
Amen to what God has done. Many, and this is just one service. We've got another service coming up next, and we're not bragging. This isn't us. I'm saying because this ministry has been funded and financed by the obedience of God's people, look at what God has done. This building was almost completely done in cash. Almost completely done in cash because of the obedience of God's people, but that was on what percent?
21%.
Imagine what God could do through us as a church with 60%, 70%, literally tripling the impact of this community for God's kingdom. Every time we say yes to Jesus in the tithe, we say yes to more people being able to say yes to Jesus. Every time we say no to the tithe, we are saying no to more people having the opportunity to say yes to Jesus. There's so many things that we would love to do. Right now, we want to do direct mail marketing. We want to send out glossy, full-color cards. And this is not why we did this series, by the way. I'm just sharing with you the impact of what we could do because of our obedience. This is not why. Listen, this church is blessed. Misty and I are blessed. He has given us really great full-time jobs. He has blessed our family. We do things on the side. He meets our needs, all right? He meets our needs. We're blessed. But I'm saying, look at what God could do if, what was the other percent?
The difference from
the
21?
The difference. Yeah, 21, 79%. Imagine if the 79% would say yes. We want to do full color, high gloss cards every time we do a new series to every home in a 10-mile radius. That would cost probably, a couple thousand maybe, to do that once a month. Do you know how many people we could reach through those mailboxes to let them know what Mountain Movers Church is and where it is? We want to do some aggressive social media advertising on Facebook, but a lot of times we have to say no. We want to have a billboard at 43 Highway and Tiff City Road right there at that junction. We want to have one at Highway 10 and 60. We want to have one. We've got one in town now. Thank you for those of you. Amen? Yeah. 21%. The 21% that have said yes, you're paying for that billboard in Grove. And don't think for one second it's not making a difference. I met a gentleman a few weeks ago at the front door, and I said, how'd you hear about us? And he said, I saw that awesome billboard in Grove. Thank you, Jesus. And his life has been forever changed as a result of what God's doing through this ministry. But there's a lot of things that we have to say no to each and every month because we're just limited. I'm not trying to bust your chops. We love you. We love you. We're not trying to make anybody feel guilty. That's not why we're up here. I want you to be blessed like JD and Josie, and like Misty and I, and like some of the many families in this church that have said yes. I want you to be blessed as they have been blessed. Does that mean God's going to make you rich? No. No. It doesn't mean you're going to be rich at all. It means you're going to have his provision and his protection in your life, and we want that for you more than anything else. So I want to just extend to you guys a challenge, okay? I want to challenge you. Now, you can go through the scriptures from cover to cover, all right? Don't get distracted. Listen to me. You can go through the scriptures cover to cover, and God tells you almost on every page, right? You'll see a clear message where God says, do not test me. Because when you test God, you're saying, I don't trust you. I don't think that you can provide or protect for me. When you test him, when you question him, when you say, God, can you really do this in my life? Can you really do this on behalf of my family? Can you really do this with me? You're saying, God, you can't. But there is one area in God's word where he says, hey, I'm giving you an open door to test me all you want. And it's in the tithe. It's in bringing your first to God, cutting right off the top of your increase and bringing it into God's local house and giving it to God in obedience. He says, go ahead and test me and watch and see if I won't bless your socks off. He says, I will open up the windows of heaven and pour out for you a blessing that you cannot even contain. That's what his word says. It's pretty awesome. So I want to challenge you in the next 90 days. I want you to try it. Try tithing. Just try it. And just watch what God does in your, look at JD and Josie. Hey, they just made the decision in their mind and God brought the increase for them, supplying their needs. I'm telling you, this is about right positioning with God. You want to tip the scale in your favor in your life. Money, all the money in the world cannot buy the peace of God that guards and surrounds my heart and mind. All the money in the world can't do that. But God's favor, His protection and His provision in my life can give me peace in any given circumstance to where I do not have to worry. God wants that for you. So try it. For the next 90 days, I want you to try giving God your tithe. Test Him in this and watch and see what He does. Would you stand up with us today? And if you would, please, if you would bow your heads, I want to take this just a step further, and I want to know, between you, me, and God, you might say, Pastor Brad, you know, I'm part of that 21%, but I've not been tithing my tithe. I've not been bringing God my first. I've not been saying yes fully to Jesus with the tithe. I might be tipping Him here and there, maybe a 5 or a 20 in the offering bucket, or I might text give 10 or 15 bucks here and there. And that is great, and we appreciate you, and we say, God bless you. Thank you so much for doing that, because you are making a difference. But maybe you would say today, Pastor Brad, I want to test God in this. And you might be one of those in the 79%, and you would say, I've not been doing it at all. And you know, we understand there's reasons why. You might just say to yourself, you know, I just never knew. I never really knew that I was supposed to tithe. I never even really thought about where the money came from in the church. It just didn't cross my mind. I think the second reason why people don't give is because things are so exciting and happening here. We're reaching so many for Christ. You're just thinking that your giving just isn't needed. And that's so far from the truth, because there's so many things we want to say yes to. The third thing might be, you would just say, Pastor, I've been here for a while. I've heard you teach on this before. I know what the tithe can do. I know I can be blessed, but I just don't want to do it. I just do not want to do it. And I would say, we still love you. You're still welcome to worship here. We love you. But maybe you're in one of those three categories. Maybe you're in that 79%, and you'd say, Pastor Brad, I want to try this. I want to try positioning myself, tipping the scale in my favor, and giving my tithe to God, bringing Him my best and my first. I want to try it. So what I want to do is I want to count to three, and when I do, I want to see who would like to take this challenge. It's just between you and me and God. Nobody's looking around. I just want to be praying for you, that God would show you, through your obedience, His blessings. So here we go. Who wants to say yes? Ready? 1, 2, 3. Who wants to take that challenge? Amen. Amen. Yes, 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 yes. Hands all over the building are saying yes. Thank you. You can put your hands down. What I want to do is I want to pray for you right now. And once again, if you're in that 21% and you're those that have been paying your tithe and bringing your first to God, I want to tell you thank you. Thank you so much for your obedience. Your saying yes to the tithe has allowed so many people to say yes to Jesus. Your faithfulness has allowed so many hundreds and hundreds of people to be impacted for eternity by the glory of Almighty God because you said yes, and I thank you. For those of you that have made this commitment, you're going to try this for the next 90 days. You're going to take the tenth off the top and give it to God. I want to pray for you right now. Father, God, I just pray that you would reveal yourself to each of these individuals that's making this commitment in a real and powerful way. God, remind them of your word. Reveal to them the truth of your word, that you will pour out blessings on their families of provision and protection. You will open the windows of heaven, and they will not even be able to contain your favor on their lives. I pray, God, right now that as they test you in this, that you will show them the reality of your word. And as all heads are bowed and eyes are closed, it's in this very moment It's the ultimate example of why we do what we do. We are the local church. We are not the fullness of God's plan. We are a part of God's plan. He put this church in Northeast Oklahoma in the middle of nowhere to reach lives like crazy for Jesus, to lead people into a real and life-changing relationship with Him that is contagious, so they could make heaven their home and they could make Him known. And so in this moment right now, I want to give you an opportunity. With heads bowed, eyes closed, I want to give you an opportunity. If you don't have a real and life-changing relationship with Jesus, if heaven is not your home and you want heaven to be your home, you want your life to never be the same again because it's wrapped up in Him, I want to pray with you. And if you will allow me, I would love to walk you through a prayer to ask God for forgiveness and to give your heart to Him forever. So on the count of three, we're going to do the same thing. If you want Jesus in your life, I'm going to count to three. And when I do, would you just raise your hand and I will pray with you. I'm not going to call you up. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm just right where you are. I want to pray with you, and we're going to pray with you as a family, as we do every single week, because this is why we do what we do. It's all about winning the lost, whatever the cost. Are you ready? You need Jesus. This is your chance. One, two, three. Who are you in this room? You want Jesus as your personal Savior. Amen. 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 And if we would, let's, as a family, let's pray this prayer together in support of those who have made this decision. You might be watching online making that decision. We want to pray with you right now. Would you repeat this prayer with me? Father God, I love you. I thank you for your Son, Jesus. Forgive me of my sins. Wipe my slate clean. Make me new, O Lord. I believe beyond the shadow of a doubt that Jesus is who He says He is. I confess Him as Lord of my life. I dedicate from this moment forward that I will live for Jesus according to His word. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen, 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 amen. Give those a hand that have received Christ today.
Hey, thanks so much for joining us today. If you want to be a part of something bigger than yourself, give to our ministry. We've made giving easy here at Mount Movers Church. If you have your smartphone, just text the number 918-223-8090. Just push in the amount you want to give and push send. It's that easy. If you don't have your smartphone, not a problem. You can mail your giving just as easy to 24,000 South 660 Road, Grove, Oklahoma, 74344. Thanks for watching today. Hey, remember, we're dreaming big for you. We'll see you next week.